Since 1999, Networks Theatre has been a home to English-speaking theatre in Orihuela, Spain. The theatre, founded by Nick Moore, has presented over 110 shows, from children's shows through to plays, musicals, theatre and education, and our proud history of 18 specially written pantomimes. Pull up a chair and join us as we meet another of our wonderful company in Networks Theatre, Conversations With. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Networks Conversations With. And this week, we're very excited because we are going live to London to talk to our actress, Laura Gómez. I'll bring her online now. Laura, hello.
Hello, how are you?
Well, very well, thank you. And yourself?
Yeah, good, good.
Good, good, good. Well, tell us, bring us up to date with what has happened to Laura since she left Networks.
Well, I did a very long journey to end up falling into a musical theatre training.
Okay.
And because I wanted to do that, but I ended up starting music and fine arts and whatnot.
Studied fine arts. I remember in Palmerau you were there, weren't you?
Yeah, that's right. And then I went into the uni and everything. But then eventually I just put my foot down and I was like, I just have to do musical theatre. This is what I have to do.
And your parents were supportive?
At the beginning, they were not sure about it because it felt like a bit alien because it's not that big an industry. Well, it's bigger now, but there wasn't so much musical theatre, and they knew that it was a hard life and stuff. So they wanted something safer for me.
Yeah, they were worried for you.
Yeah, that's right.
I think that happens to a lot of people, and it happened to myself as well. Going into the theatre industry, people say, well, what if it goes wrong? And of course, for young people with their dreams, you don't want to hear that, really. What if it goes right?
Yeah, exactly.
So where did you study in London?
Well, in London, I trained at the MTA.
Right. Tell us what MTA stands for.
Musical Theatre Academy.
Okay. So, and how many years was that?
Yeah, it's a 2-year intensive course without like summer holidays and stuff. It's like very full on, 4 terms a year with a show at the end of every term with people from the industry and everything.
You must have been exhausted by the end.
I was exhausted, but it was great.
And what were some of the highlights of doing that course?
Well, we got to do an original musical theatre show that was written for our class. And we did a panto, which I had already done with you, and it was great because I was like, oh, yes, we're back doing this. I love this.
Do I remember you played the baddie?
I have never played the baddie with you.
No, but did you? No, no.
In my panto here,
your panto, you did.
Yeah.
I remember seeing some photos.
Yeah, I was the baddie in our panto. I was Countess Grimalova from Cinderella. Yeah.
That's fabulous. Okay, yeah. let's take you back to Networks Theatre. When did you first start the Academy, Networks English Academy?
Oh, gosh. I remember I did a summer course. But I must have been like 8 or 9, something like that.
A summer course with Ken and Anne.
Yes.
Yeah, Ken and Anne used to do a summer course in the summer as a kind of introduction to Networks. And that's what you did?
Yeah, that's what I did. And I loved it. I absolutely loved everything we did there.
Okay.
My sister
used to do manualidades, making things, and they probably did some songs as well, did they?
Yeah, that's right. And that was exactly what I loved. So it was all put together and in English. And I was like, yeah, great. Okay. And I have very vivid memories of it, actually, which I don't remember anything from the past. I don't remember what I ate yesterday.
No,
but
sure.
I have very vivid memories from that course.
Isn't it great how something like that can stick in your memory?
I know, right?
Yeah,
it's kind of crazy. But then my sister was in Networks already because she's older than me, so my mum was just trying to get me to go as well. And then after that course, I think I started with Dennis Malone.
Okay, you with Dennis? Okay,
yeah.
Your sister Remy was in one production with us.
Yeah,
she was in Kinder Transport.
Yeah, that's right.
I remember that. Okay, so you joined Networks, the English Academy, your teacher was Dennis, and
I think I remember that you didn't participate in any of our theatre courses.
No.
Laura Gómez, where were you?
I was at the conservatory and I was doing ballet and I was doing all that stuff. So my mum thought that it was too much if I also did like theatre, because it was like every day of the week.
Yeah, it is very intensive. And a lot of people who are in the conservatory can't attend. Also, like kids who play football and stuff, they don't want to give it up. What were you learning in the conservatory?
Clarinet.
Clarinet, okay. But you also, I've seen you playing the ukulele or the mini guitar. What's it called?
Yeah, I play the ukulele now.
Okay, okay. Are you self-taught?
Yeah, I started during the pandemic because I've always wanted to learn, but I was too scared because it feels like very difficult. But ukulele is a bit easier because it's only four, so.
Okay, okay. Well, I heard one of your videos on Instagram the other day. And I thought it was brilliant. It's very,
thank you.
It's a very funny instrument, isn't it? But if you like comedy, it's a very kind of entertaining instrument.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it. It's perfect for you because you're so good at comedy.
Oh, thank you.
Dear old me, sashay away. Get ready for your execution. Cause brand new me is here to stay. With my 20 New Year resolutions. Cause this is a love song for 2022. I'm definitely not asking too much of you. I wrote my goals on a dream board app, so I'm absolutely fucking sure this year won't be crap. What are you gonna do? Well, I'm gonna eat so healthy that my guts are gonna have a shock. We'll journal every day and work out, meditate and lose my job. I'm gonna master mindfulness till I don't need to talk. And when I feel completely stressed, I'll foster 27 dogs. I'll meet my friends, so myself, I'll a restraining order. Then I'll follow Marie Kondo so I stop being a hoarder. I'll go outside my comfort zone and date people from South London. Then I'll paraglide, travel the world, pretend I have a trust fund. I'll also ride the newest hit and finally be successful. Find a partner who wants to commit and we'll have something special. I'll manifest so loud my neighbors will call their police. And after blocking toxic people, find the answer to world peace. I think we can do that. Cause this is a love song for 2022. I'm definitely not asking too much of you. I wrote my goals on a dream board app, so I'm absolutely fucking sure this year won't be crap. Let's do it!
Your first show. Now, I was thinking last night, memory serves me right. It was Cinderella.
Yeah.
It was the pantomime.
Yeah, it was.
So you were straight in with the panto. Who was also in the cast at the time? Do you remember?
I remember it was Diana, Marta, Maria, who was Cinderella. Gosh, I'm looking terrible.
Was David Vedeco, was he Buttons?
Yes.
Oh, it was that production. Okay. Because we repeat the pantomimes over 20 years. We've repeated Cinderella three or four times. So for some of us who are connected to the theatre, it's like, well, who was Buttons and who was Cinderella?
Yeah.
What was your what did you think of pantomime when you suddenly found yourself as part of the cast?
Oh, I really liked it. But at that point, I don't think I was aware of what the whole pantomime thing kind of was fully, because I was a dancer, so I was just like kind of in the background doing the dances and like taking part in everything, but I wasn't like, nothing was purely sinking as much, I don't think.
No.
I think I understood panto better like later on than in that. I don't know why. I mean, I was a bit like, oh my gosh, I'm finally doing this. And I was with Sarah as well, because it was my first like adult show, and you thought we were in third of ESO, but we were in second of ESO, and you found out too late, and it was like, oh.
Yeah, because there is a kind of cutoff point where people who do the theatre course are in fifth and sixth of primary, first and second of senior school, ESO, and normally people in third of ESO become the dancers, but you were in second, were you?
Yeah, we were.
Right, okay. Well, we'll make sure that doesn't happen. No, of course, that's brilliant. It happens all the time. People slip in younger. Jose Angel Zaragoza, for example, he participated, I think, in Treasure Island when he was only in second of ESO, and it should have... Anyway, Good, okay. Later on, you returned to another pantomime because you took a larger singing role in A Christmas Carol.
Yeah, yes, but my one after Cinderella was Dick Whittington.
Ah, oh, was a cat. Lest we forget. Absolutely. You were Dick Whittington's cat.
Yeah.
How did you find that experience?
It was so fun. It was like, I didn't know what to expect, but I was very shy and I was very like insecure back in the day. So it was like getting me out of my comfort zone, like big time. Yeah. So.
Well, if you're shy, of course, as the cat, you can kind of hide a bit behind the makeup. Do you remember your one line as the cat?
Well, I only said meow.
Exactly.
Which is great because my memory is not great.
I do remember saying to you that your one line might be meow, but you get to say it 100 different ways.
Yeah.
And that's the skill. And then, of course, the fairy gives the cat the voice in one song. Do you remember what song that was?
Yeah, it was Shine.
Yeah.
I sang it with Pilar.
I just, as a pantomime writer, that song Shine is just perfect for that moment when Dick is feeling dejected and has to turn around and go back to London. Of course, now you are in London.
I am.
Have you been to see a professional pantomime since you've been in Britain?
Can you believe I haven't?
No.
I haven't.
No. No. Anyway, don't worry. Let's not talk about that. It's a wonderful experience where you have like 1,200 people all shouting at the stage. You know, not like when I'm there where they all shout, get off.
Well, that happened to me once.
Oh, really?
Yeah, in A Christmas Carol. I remember the movie just came out. This is a bit dramatic, but I'm going to say it anyway. When Christmas Carol came out, the movie had come out the same Christmas. And the person who played my character in the movie was an absolute gorgeous, like, model actress or something. And then I remember coming on stage for Harvard Panto and someone shouting from the crowd, "The one in the movie was prettier!" And I was like, what? Now it's a funny story. Back then I was like, how dare you? But those things happen in Panto when there's no kind of it feels like it's very together with the
when you hear something like that, does it make you stronger?
Well, I guess so. I mean, I just take things with humor. So that happened to me and now it's just a funny story. But I guess at the time it maybe didn't feel as funny right in the moment, but it didn't affect me as much because I was like, don't care, whatever.
Yeah, you see, I chose you for the part because you were the most talented and the best person for that role. And especially because I wanted to hear your voice as a solo on the network stage. Because one thing I try to do with casting is that even if you are just a dancer, then somebody tells me, oh, by the way, you know, she can sing. And then I'll stand next to you in one of the rehearsals without you realizing it. I'll go and stand there, pretend I'm directing, which is what I do anyway, pretend I'm directing. And just stand next to you and like, okay, bang, we need you in Networks Theatre.
One regret from yesterday that just seems to grow with time. There's no use looking back or wondering how it could be now.
And that's why I remember the star concert we did. You participated in our star concert. And what song did you sing?
I sang Let It Go.
Let It Go. And it literally, it brought the house down. You knocked it out of the park. It was amazing. So that kid who shouted, "The girl in the film was prettier," We send a little message to them, don't we?
Yes.
Wow.
Let it go! Let it go!
Amazing talent, Laura, and I wish you every success for your career.
Oh, thank you so much, Nick.
You're now in London, and what's the kind of, I was going to carry on talking about Networks Theatre, but what's the kind of day-to-day reality of trying to be an actress in a big city like London?
It's weird because since I graduated, like a few months afterwards, it was the pandemic, so we didn't get the full experience. And I guess it's coming back now.
Yeah,
there's more auditions and everything. But basically, you have a job that you kind of do to survive, and if you're lucky enough.
What is your kind of standby job?
I teach performing arts to children, and I teach private like singing lessons and drama and acting. And
it's exactly what I did. And
yeah.
Every Wednesday night and every Friday night, I would go and do these acting classes. And 10 years later, these acting classes gave me the inspiration to start Networks Theatre. So
yeah.
Everything contributes to what you're going to do in the future. So you have some students that you're now helping that have dreams of West End stardom and fame.
Yeah, that's right. So I got some students that are, I got young students usually in groups, but I also have some private like singing little ones that want to learn, and some people that want to audition for drama school and need some guidance with that, and some adults that want to do it for fun.
Okay, and it keeps you busy, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it's good. And my private teaching, I am my own boss at the end of the day, which is very helpful when I have to literally drop everything, because I got an audition at 8 p.m. the night before, which happens very often.
Sure.
Okay. So, yeah.
Right, let's get back to Networks Theatre. So you did Cinderella, you did Dick Whittington, an award-winning performance, I remember.
Oh, yeah, I won Best Supporting Actor.
In the Networks Theatre Awards.
Yeah.
And then you did Christmas Carol. You also appeared in other productions. I remember you appearing in When I Was Me.
Yes.
What do you remember about that show?
Well, that was like a different kind of show, because we usually did like upbeat comedy kind of more stories, and that was like, I remember you approached us with the plot of it, and it was like, oh, that sounds really interesting. Like, I loved acting, so I was like, oh yes, some serious acting here, let's do this. Yeah. Okay. So, and I remember you said, I think you already had in mind the bringing the show to schools when we started doing it. No, I remember we were gonna do it. We were gonna go to somewhere else, to London or something, or to the UK.
It was the idea to take it to the UK, but it's so complicated to do things like that that unfortunately it just didn't happen.
But I remember
we were going to do an exchange there's like an ESSA, no, there's like a bachelier available in Britain that you can do with performing arts.
Mm.
And we were going to exchange with a school that were there, but it just never happened, unfortunately.
But I remember I used that to sell it to my parents, because even though I was already doing theatre, I don't know if you remember, they only allowed me to do one play a year.
Right.
Because I was too busy and they didn't want me to overload with things and get too tired or something. And I remember I had already done Dick Whittington in that school year. I think it was Dick Whittington. Ooh. And I told them like, no, but look, this show, we might bring it to the UK. We have to do it. Like, I have to do this show.
Yeah.
And I ended up convincing them anyway. So that's probably why I convinced them. It was the same with Odysseus, because I remember Odysseus was going to go to the... to the Teatro Circo.
Correct, yeah. We did, well, which we did do eventually, yeah.
Yeah.
Odysseus, for anybody watching that doesn't know, was our songs with the music of a rather popular 70s and 80s rock group. And it was the story of Odysseus, but basically in a very, very comic way, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Did you play in that?
Oof, I don't remember. I was someone.
One of the sailors, yeah. Okay. Did you not sing Who Wants to Live Forever?
No, that was Carmen in my production of it.
Well, that I missed a trick there, didn't I?
It's okay. You didn't know. I remember you only knew.
Should have made it a duet.
Ooh.
Oh.
She was great anyway.
Yeah, no, she was. Absolutely.
But you learned about me being able to sing because Sarah told you. And that's when it was before.
Sarah Baesta.
Yeah.
Baesta. I know Baesta, Baesta, Baesta.
Baesta, yeah.
Baesta, okay, yeah.
I think it was before Dick Whittington or before the Scarecrow Girl. I don't remember.
Oh, Scarecrow Girl. Okay, yeah. All these great shows. Bloody hell. Christmas Carol. No, Christmas Carol. Oh, that's the children's show. Yeah, no, Christmas Carol came after, I think. So many shows. Anyway, good. Okay. So you've done When I Was Me, you did Odysseus. Your sister was in Kinder Transport, were you?
No.
Okay. What was your final show when you were with us?
When I Was Me.
That was When I Was Me, was it?
Yeah.
Wow, that means 2010,
I think.
So you haven't been in a show in the new theatre?
No.
Wow.
The only show I did in the new theatre, it was Gerai's Stand Up for Talent.
Ah, well then you have been in a show.
Yeah, I have been in the theatre, yeah.
Yeah. What did you do in Stand Up for Talent?
Well, I think I joined for the two of them.
Yeah.
The first one, I just sang a song.
Okay.
And then I sang a duet with Maria Ortiz. And in the second one, I remember I did a bit of comedy stuff with him and Pilar, and then I sang Whatever Happened to My Part from Spamalot.
Oh, yeah, fabulous. Whatever Happened to My Part.
Yeah.
Oh, lovely. It's good. Again, great song for you, because you can show the comedy and you can show the voice.
That's it.
Absolutely, yeah.
Una beba que subiese un
participated in the theatre, did you know then that this was the career you wanted to pursue?
I don't know if at the beginning I knew. I had known because I started doing theatre when I was 7 with Sara at school. And I had done some theatre outside of networks before. And I just really liked it, but I didn't consider it like it was a proper career. I guess like knowing more about musicals, and we went to see musicals with networks and that, I think.
Do you remember? What did we go and see?
Yeah, I remember, like, actually one of the shows that I always considered that was the show that made me want to go into theatre was when we went together to see Sweeney Todd.
Yeah. Did you come with us to see Follies?
No, I didn't see Follies. I went when we went to see Les Mis. And,
oh, yes. Yeah, yeah.
And Sweeney Todd. I think those were the only two that...
Yeah. But it is nice when you have these dreams of being an actor, to like... Because Oranvale is a small town, let's face it. It is a tiny town in quite away from the centre. 5 hours on a coach. And we would get the coach at 8 o'clock in the morning, arrive around lunchtime, have a bit to eat. You'd like have 2 hours to walk around Madrid. 5 o'clock is the show. By 7:45, we're back on the road down to Orihuela. Mm. And that 5 o'clock show is an opportunity to see professional actors in a big theatre. Yeah. And it can be really inspiring.
It is, yeah. I think that was it, because until then it was more like, we're just playing, we're just having fun and doing shows, whatever. But it doesn't feel like, I don't think I saw it as a like career as much, because it was just us all doing theatre together.
Yeah.
And then I think seeing that and seeing like what the power of it, because it was, that production was one of the best things I've seen.
Sweeney was great, yeah.
It was so good. And it just, it kind of, something clicked and I was like, so this is a career.
Well, hopefully some of the shows you did at networks will also, you know, stay in the memory and inspire you for other things you've done, especially if one day you start to write your own stuff.
Mm.
Because so many times I say to people who are in networks, oh, I want to be an actor. And I'll say to them, okay, you'll end up being a teacher as well. You need to learn how to write, produce your own stuff, because if you don't, nobody's going to come knocking on your door. The people who are lucky enough to get called, the top 1%.
Yeah.
Everybody else has got to go knocking on those doors. But of course, you know that, don't you?
Yeah.
One final question about networks. You mentioned Scarecrow Girl. What do you remember about that show?
Oh, I love that show. I loved it. It was, I remember it was based on a book.
Yes.
I remember reading the book, and the story was lovely. And it was a very different feeling to all the shows that we had done together as well, because it was more like intimate, and the story was a bit more sad than others than we had done, and the music was also different. I don't know what music you used in that time, but I remember the melodies were very different to others that we had that we had been singing, and it was really interesting, that show. I loved it.
I found a 1980s instrumental LP. There's a man called Gordon Giltrap who had released an instrumental LP, long playing record.
Mm.
And it just inspired me to write these different kind of songs. Scarecrow Girl, for anybody who doesn't know, is the story of a girl called Luella who lives with her two brothers in the forest. And her mother, because of the economy, is forced to go away to America to find work. And the local neighbor promises that she'll oversee them. When the neighbor is taken into hospital, the authorities come in to try and take her into care. Sorry, I'm just having a flashback about which Scarecrow Girl you did. You did the first one, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Did you have cakes thrown at you?
Yes,
I remember that. Yeah, it's always the favorite moment where people get to throw cakes on stage. It was lovely. Yeah, it's a nice play, and we did it again in 2016. And the great thing about Networks is after writing 55 shows, I'm probably not going to be writing anymore. And I can take a show from 8 years ago and the current actors can perform it as if it's new, you know. We don't have to keep churning out new stuff. Laura, you've been a part, a very important part of Networks with all the shows you did. And I want to say thank you for that, because you really have made a memorable contribution.
No, thank you.
We're going to finish now with a couple of minutes of crazy questions, okay? Are you ready, ready, ready?
I am ready.
Is, I haven't got my phone to work out. I'll have to guess when 2 minutes is, okay? Because I haven't got my iPad here to tell me 2 minutes. But here we go. Pizza or pasta?
Pasta.
Why?
I don't know. You can add a lot of stuff to it.
You can with pizza.
I know. I don't know why I say that.
Do you believe in ghosts?
No.
Absolutely sure?
No, absolutely sure. But I want to convince myself that they don't exist.
Okay. How many pairs of shoes do you own?
Oh, I don't know. Probably like 20 or something. Really? Even I only use one pair.
Oh, yeah, all the time. Yeah. What's the best city in the world?
Barcelona.
Why Barcelona?
I don't know. I really like Barcelona. It's got like sea and city and a lot of artistic buildings.
Okay. Would you prefer, that's a tricky question, would you prefer to fight one horse-sized duck or 20 duck-sized horses?
One horse-sized duck.
Why?
Because it would probably be easier to kind of, like, you know, if it's going for me, I can...
I like the way you acted.
It would be easier to dodge than a lot of little horses. What if you step on them and then you hear them like, eh? No, I can't do that.
Okay. If you could time travel, where would you go?
Oh, this is hard. Probably to like the Victorian times or something, so I can just stay in my room and not do anything. No, I don't know.
You want to go back to poverty and childhood?
Yeah, no, I take that back. The 70s.
The 70s, a bit of flower power.
Yes.
Okay. What book, Spanish or English, would you recommend?
Ooh. So there's this book by Dolly Arterton. Oh God, I'm gonna say that wrong. Anyway, she's a news. Oh God, I can't speak English today. She's a writer for articles. Okay. Journalist, that's the word.
Good. We'll try and flash it up on the screen so people can.
Yeah, and it's called Everything I Know About Love. And it's basically her story. And as a young woman, like, it's really interesting because I related to a lot in that book and it was really interesting to read.
Okay, we'll put the cover up on the screen so people can see it. Would you like a small part in a pantomime or a big part in a play?
Big point of play.
Why is that? Well, so you have more meat, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. What part would you give Boris Johnson in a pantomime?
A tree in the background.
A tree in the background, yeah. And he'd still get that wrong, wouldn't he?
Oh,
okay,
yeah.
Final question. Would you prefer to speak a speech, dance a dance, or sing a song?
Sing a song,
okay. What's your current fave song at the moment?
Ooh, I'm listening to a lot of Brandy Carlisle.
Okay. I have no idea who that is, but...
It's great.
Okay, sing a songwriter, okay. I shall ask Alexa when we get offline. Yeah. Laura, it has been an absolute joy to talk to you. What's great about these interviews is I get to connect with people who I haven't seen for quite a while, although we are in contact in WhatsApp, I know, but somebody I haven't seen for a long time. If people want to follow you, can they find you on Instagram?
Yes, they can find me on Instagram. It's Laura Gómez G-G-E-E.
Okay, G-E-E, Laura Gómez G-E-E. Okay, fabulous. Laura, have a fantastic day. Thank you so much for being a part of Conversations With, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you, same. It was lovely to chat with you today. Thank you
Bye-bye.
For calling me. Bye.
There you are, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Thank you so much for watching Networks Theatre Conversations With, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.